Bob. It's breakfast with Bob. It's breakfast with Bob.
Poncho Man. Wrapping up day two of Breakfast with Bob. We are brought to you by EAS Sports Nutrition, Hoka One One, Polar, Oska Wellness, Velo Fix, Four Seasons Huala Live, where we'll be hosting our World Championship edition on Sunday. And we are on triathlonworld.com. Our next guest, seriously one of our favorite people around, former steeplechaser, multiple time 70.3 world champion, Melissa Halschut. How are you doing?
I'm doing good, Bob. You love your steeplechasers, don't you?
I love the steeplechasers. I was talking to Jesse yesterday. Yeah. I just think that there's a toughness that you guys have that is just unparalleled. I mean, you guys know how to suffer, right? That is a brutal sport.
Yeah, it's a crazy sport. I think most people watch it just for the stacks.
We watch it to hang by the pit and watch people go down and get spiked. Yep. It's the best thing there is. But you went from a 9-minute event to basically to a 9-hour event in this Ironman thing. And we've been here the last couple of years going, Melissa's going to have a great race, and you haven't been able to get to the starting line for, you know, you got broken rib and all sorts of different stuff. So this will be your first time racing this race.
Yeah, it's so exciting to be here actually racing this time. The last 2 years I had flights booked, accommodation, everything. So I still had to come and watch it. And I guess the first time it was all right. I learned a lot, and I thought, you know, people come a year before they plan to race and scout it all out. So, you know, I dealt with that. But then I had to do it again another year. So third time lucky this year.
Yeah. You didn't need to scout the second year. You sort of knew what this thing was about. And do you feel this race, the course and everything about it, because you've been on it a bunch now, does it suit you?
I think so. I like the heat and humidity.
Yes.
It's tough, but I think I do better in the heat and humidity than a lot of others because, you know, we live in a really hot and humid climate.
Yes.
I like long rolling hills, so I think that will really suit me. And, hopefully.
You can't wait, huh? You're pretty excited. So when I look back at everything you've done in steeplechase and silver medal and gold at the Goodwill Games, but, you know, two-time 70.3 world champion, and you've dominated at 70.3, and you just took second at Worlds here recently in Mooloolaba. And remember Holly Lawrence, who's not doing the full. She's a half specialist, and you were second there. What did you take from this season? Has been a phenomenal season for you, right? With winning the Euro Champs at Wiesbaden, Ironman Europe in 901. And I think you had a stand down of some sort in Frankfurt. So you would have been under 9 hours there. This has been a great season for you.
Yeah, it has been really good. It was a really slow start to the year. I had complications with my rib again early in the year. And, you know, I thought I'm going to miss Kona again because the races were just ticking by and I hadn't qualified. And Frankfurt was the last regional championship
race. So that
was
really the last, and you had
to. So I had to win it.
That's right, because otherwise you had to get points and stuff, right?
Yeah, I had absolutely no points. I didn't race last year. And, so I had to win it. So everything was on that race. And, won that and then race Wiesbaden a few weeks later, and that went well. So, I feel like now I've had a really good season, even though I've only done a handful of races.
But it's interesting if you think way back to the days that someone like a Dave Scott made a season really in October every year, right? It's all about peaking at the end of the season is really what it's about anyways. If you had been healthy at the beginning of the year, maybe you might have burned yourself out a little bit.
Yeah. Well, I've definitely had a good rest. I didn't train halfway through the year.
So really, when could you start training again? Because that whole rib thing.
I started training around June.
Yeah.
And then raced. I think I had about 6 weeks training.
6 weeks for Frankfurt.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. And it's not like Frankfurt is one of those races. It's a regional championship, so everybody's there.
Yeah.
It's a great field.
Yeah, it was an awesome field. You know, I had Daniela Reif to contend with. The pressure was on, but I knew if I wanted to do Kona, I had to win it. So, I was really confident going into it, and luckily it paid off.
So what does it do for your confidence when you've got someone like a Daniela Reif in the race and you beat her, right? And she's the reigning world champion.
Yeah, it was really good to come up against her earlier on rather than, you know, meeting everybody at Kona.
Yes.
Ironman's still fairly new to me, so many of the girls I've never raced over Ironman.
Right.
So, it was really good to have a really good field and have a good race there.
How many Ironmans have you done now?
3.
You've only done 3? That's good. Less is more when it comes to that thing.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, so after you, you know, going into Mooloolaba, did you, you were still training, I'm guessing, specifically for this, rather than focusing all your cards on Mooloolaba?
Yeah, I guess the last couple of years with my injury history, I've kind of been playing it a bit safe.
Yes.
I haven't been running that much. I did a bit of a block leading into Frankfurt and then backed it off again. So,
right.
Yeah, no, I really didn't start my Kona block until after Mooloolaba, about 3 days after.
Okay, so you focused on that and then, yeah.
Yeah.
And your body held up for this last running block.
Yeah. Well, I only had 5 weeks from Mooloolaba until this, so I thought, well, you can't get injured in that amount of time. So,
no.
Yeah, hit it hard for 3 weeks and then, yeah, taper again.
So the step up from the Ironman 70.3, which, again, you won two world titles at that, how tough was that to transition from that to longer? Because it got to the point where people were racing those 70.3s almost like their Olympic distance, right?
Yeah, and they're getting fast.
They're getting fast, and everybody's racing, where this is the mental side, the nutrition, the pacing, and, you know, was that difficult for you?
Yeah, I think the main thing, like you say, is the nutrition and the pacing. Obviously, coming from 3K running, 9 minutes, you got to make sure you're watching your watch and running slow enough at the start. It should feel like a walk in the park at the start.
And does
so that's
it feel
the
like that?
Part.
Is that? Do you feel when you're out there like, God, this feels really slow?
Yeah, at the start. And, yeah, I've been practicing that in training. Just, you know, it's hard to slow down enough because you're not going to run a marathon every day in training. So
no.
You want to get used to running that marathon pace, but you're only running it for maybe 10K. So, yeah, that was hard to learn. But, yeah, hopefully I've got it all worked out now.
What I love is I don't think there's very many women in the field who've gone, you know, 15:55 for 5K or, you know, 2:05 for the 800 or 4:31 for the mile.
I better not go out in that pace.
Yeah. If you do that in the first mile, we'll pick you off the pavement somewhere else. So, I mean, do you draw on that you've got that raw speed that a lot of other folks simply have never had?
Yeah, I think because I've been running since 11 years old, I've got that in the bank still.
Yes.
I don't need to run as much as the other girls. Leading into Frankfurt, I was running 40-50k a week, and I know my competition's doing 100 plus, but
right.
I just couldn't handle that at the moment with my broken rib, and yeah, I was doing a lot on the bike instead, getting my endurance there, and it was working out. I could run a marathon, and I didn't know how off 50k a week, but
well, what's fascinating is I remember talking to this coach, Bobby McGee, who coached Gwen Jorgensen, and he was saying that they'd replaced a lot of the high-intensity running workouts with anaerobic workouts on the bike because just to keep the running down. Do you find that you do a lot more high-intensity on the bike and that transfers over to the run?
Yeah. I do 3 quality sessions on the bike, and all my rides pretty much are solid.
Yes, you don't rides.
Yeah, no. There's no junk miles there.
Right.
And then with the run, because I'm only running a little bit, I try to get my quality and race pace stuff there.
Sure.
Again, no junk miles, no 6 minute a K runs just for the hell of
Who
it.
Who would do 6 minutes a K? What the heck? What a waste of time that is. I hate that. When you look back at your, it's you know, like you said, 11 years old, your a career as an endurance athlete, what events stick out to you as your favorites in terms of you felt that you got the most out of yourself those days?
In running, I never thought I fulfilled my potential.
Really? Even with Commonwealth, silver,
and all that
stuff? Yeah.
I did Commonwealth off 2 months training. I could not string more than 3 months together.
Injuries.
In the end.
Injuries.
Yeah.
Is that what moved you into triathlon?
Yeah, it did. I got sick of, just, you know, sitting on the bed, just waiting for the injuries to heal. So that's when I bought a bike and I thought, oh, I'll just do a few rides just as cross training.
Yeah.
And then just fell into triathlon.
That is wild. And then when did you have your sort of breakthrough triathlon where you realized, okay, I this could be my new thing?
Well, I won my first few races.
Yeah. Were you a pro at that point? No.
Yeah.
You were a pro right away.
I raced, yeah.
Yeah. Why be an age grouper? I'm just going to be a pro. I like it.
Yeah, I'd never swum before, so I jumped straight into a half Ironman.
Was that your first
and
triathlon?
Yeah.
Yeah, half was the first and you won it.
Yeah.
I hate people like you. That is so funny. So you won your first race and your first race was a half Ironman.
Yeah. Yeah.
That is amazing.
So I guess that's when everybody thought, yep, she's going to be a triathlete, but secretly I was like, I never want to do that again.
Really? So you were like finishing and going, yeah, that was not that great.
Yeah, I said to my husband, I'm like, maybe I can still make it as a runner because I don't want to do that.
Wow. And, but then obviously you kept going.
Yeah, yeah. I actually, after that first one, I was still trying for the Commonwealth Games for running.
Yes.
And yeah, I just couldn't do the Ks that were needed. You know, as a pure runner, you're running 150 plus K a week.
Right.
And I just couldn't handle that. So I entered another triathlon race, and standing on the start line, I was like, I cannot believe I'm doing this again. But then came second to Caroline Steffen, who's the Asia Pacific champs. So I thought, oh, maybe I can give it a go. And that's when I started thinking, you know, maybe I can make a career of this. And the second one was nowhere near as bad as the first. So.
It was bad, but not that bad.
Yeah.
And then when you win Ironman 70.3, I mean, that for the first time, that sort of changes everything, right? Then all of a sudden people look at you as, once you win 70.3, they go, well, then you can win Kona, right? It's like a natural progression. It's sort of like if you've run the 100 on the track and you're good at that you should
you
be able
do
to
the
win
marathon.
It. Yeah, why can't you run a marathon? Why not? Yeah. Is that the way you sort of looked at it? Yeah, I just won 70.3, but that was a long way.
Yeah, yeah. Well, winning the world 70.3 in my first full year as a triathlete, everyone obviously is like, okay, well, next is Kona.
And then that'll be next. And what year, the first time you won it was?
2011.
11, okay, yeah.
Yeah, so, yeah, I was just like, that's a long way to go. Like, 21K was still a long way to run. So,
right.
Yeah, I was a bit nervous about that, but I guess I got pressured into it. And then, so I started training for Ironman to do one in 2012 and broke down. So then I was like, that's it. I'm going to do Kona when I'm ready. So 2014 was the plan.
Okay. So then 13, you won 70.3 Worlds again.
Yeah.
Okay. So you're still maintaining the 2014. And then you come. Now, did you get your rib injury here on the island?
No, it was 3 days before 70.3 World Champs in 2014 in Boulder.
Yes.
Yeah.
And that was the massage.
So it was a massage injury. Yes.
You don't see a lot of those, but no. I can see where it can happen because you're fairly slight and one of those big guys can obviously break a rib fairly easily.
Yeah. Well, he was pushing all his weight and just accidentally slipped.
Yes.
So, dislocated the rib and tore the pec. So.
Oh, my God.
Wasn't nice.
No, it was not nice at all. So, and it's not like as somebody who's trying to improve their swimming anyways, that's all you need is a little more something else to compromise your swimming ability.
Yeah, yeah, that was tough. The reason I actually got the massage was to loosen up my upper body so that I could swim better. And then I couldn't swim for 2 months after it.
That is wild. And so was it just this summer that you started feeling good? So you were basically there for a couple of years. Or a good solid year and a half.
So that was 2014, the pec and the rib. But then in 2015, in March, I actually broke a rib on my back.
And so, how'd you do that?
Apparently coughing.
And I bet you think it probably had something to do with the other one being compromised?
Well, that's what the physio thinks.
Yes.
I was a bit unbalanced.
Yeah.
And I just had a really bad chest infection and coughing. And then, you know, I guess you don't assume you're going to break a rib coughing. So
right.
I didn't think it was anything. So I trained through it and got massage. And I'm like, oh, I'm just getting a bit tight. So can you massage that? And I guess that made it a lot worse. And that never healed. So that it still is broken today.
Is it really?
Yeah.
Do you notice it? Is it something that bothers
you? I have to get constant treatment on it.
Yeah.
It's called radiofrequency neurotomy.
Okay.
So it's pretty much telling the brain that the injury is okay. You can train on it. It just blocks the pain signal. So, it lasted a year. I just got the treatment done just before 70.3 Worlds again. So, it might be an ongoing thing. But
you need to start going to medical school. You become a professional at all this stuff. So your first time you went to first triathlon you ever did, you won. First 70.3 you ever did, you won, right? Or first 70.3 Worlds you did, you won. So this is your first time here. There's sort of a pattern.
That'd be a nice pattern.
Wouldn't
it
be a nice pattern? I mean, after the last 2 years of not being able to race here, when I look at the field, obviously it's very deep. You've got Danielle Reef, defending champion, three-time champion Marinda Carfrae, Leanda Cave, who won in 2012, a bunch of others. But there, in my mind, there's no reason that you can't win this race.
Yeah, well, training's going really well.
I
think I'm capable of winning it.
Yes.
Obviously, in Ironman, it's a bit different to a running race. Usually, the favorite wins in a running race,
yes.
But anything can happen here. You know,
right.
You drop one bottle and your race could be over. But, training's been going great. I'm in really good form. And Yeah, I hope I can win it.
I would love it. Hey, Mel, thanks so much for taking time. Always such a pleasure to talk to a steeplechaser / 70.3 champion / Ironman.
All of the above.
All the above. Mel Halstead has been our guest. Poncho Man, take us out.
Oh, it's Aloha Tuesday. I'm going to run to Saturday. It's breakfast with Bob.
Thank you, Poncho Man.
Hi.